Railway bridge ties are useful for keeping trains right on track. Bridge ties are usually made of wood, bolted to steel support beams on concrete piers, forming the viaduct. The actual rails a train travels on are bolted to these wooden ties, which help absorb noise and vibration. The size of the ties is determined by the load the railway bridge has to carry. To calculate that load, engineers have to factor in the number of tracks, the volume of train traffic, the weight of any cargo to be transported, and whether the bridge is straight or not, because a curve puts additional stress on the structure. Oak is the wood of choice, because it's hard and durable. When the logs arrive at the sawmill, they come face to face with a device called a debarker. The wood is moved along a conveyor to the debarker. A single log is dropped into spinning rollers in front of the machine. The rollers rotate the log while the debarker makes its way from one end to the other, removing the bark with its sharp tooth blades. The stripped bark is put to good use. It gets processed into gardening mulch. Leftover sawdust is burned in a wood-fired boiler that runs another part of the plant. Next, the logs drop one at a time into a carriage that takes them through a circular saw. The carriage has sensors which measure the dimensions of the log and reports them to the console located in the operator's cab. Once given the data, the operator uses a joystick controller to flip the log into whichever position maximizes the yield. The first few runs trim off the rough surface and square the shape. The next few runs cut boards which the sawmill sells on for use as flooring. The log is now the exact dimensions required for a bridge tie. Just like in the debarking process, nothing is wasted. Offcuts will be made into wood chips and sent to companies that make chipboard and other similar construction materials. The ties are then stacked ready for transfer to the bridge mill next door. The role of the bridge mill is to frame the bridge, a process also known as dapping. They'll create the specific holes and notches in each tie that will be used for attaching it to the steel beam on which it will sit. At the bridge mill, the bridge layout supervisor processes one tie at a time. The engineer's blueprints are used to assign a number to each and every tie, and to specify precisely where the saw has to cut notches, and where the drill has to bore holes. The locations of these notches and holes vary, depending on the tie's position on the bridge, so the blueprints must be followed exactly. Once everything is measured and marked up, the tie is sent to the dap saw. The operator sets up each cut, lining up the mark with lasers, which indicate where and how deep the blade needs to penetrate. The notches just the right size to fit over the steel beam on which the tie will lie. Next, holes are bored for bolts using a drill press. The bolts will go through the tie to secure it to the steel beams. Each tie receives a metal identification tag, listing, among other things, the bridge and the tie numbers. A mesh plate made of rust-proof galvanized steel is nailed to each end. The plate has teeth designed to grasp and hold the wood fiber together to prevent the ends from splitting. The ID tag is nailed to one of the end plates, and then they're both forced in by a press. The last stop is the treatment plant. Here the ties will spend 24 hours inside a high-temperature, high-pressure chamber, whilst the creosote borate solution penetrates right through them. This protects the wood, extending the tie's lifespan from about a decade to at least 25 years of safely supporting a railway over a bridge, troubled water or not. biplane's lower wings have ailerons, which bank the aeroplane to the left or right. On the tail, elevators pitch the nose up or down, while a rudder steers it to the left or right. There's a propeller on the front for, well, propulsion. Each wing has two spars, or wooden beams, at the front and rear. These form the perimeter structure. The spars are made from Sitka spruce, which is exceedingly light yet exceptionally strong. It's one of only a few woods approved for structural use in aeroplanes. Once the wood is cut to the right shape for the spars, attachment plates made of spruce and mahogany plywood are mounted. These are for the end struts, vertical steel bars which will connect the upper and lower wings. The spars' contours are refined, first with a hand plane and then with an electric plane. Each wing will have 15 structural ribs made from strips of the same spruce. Long strips, which have been soaked in water for a week to make them pliable, are inserted by one end into a curved fixture and then left to dry. A few days later, the strips are removed. They now have a permanent aerodynamic curve. The two are glued together to form the perimeter of one rib. Short diagonal strips, called trusses, are glued in between. Both sides of each intersection are reinforced with a rectangular piece called a gusset. The 15 ribs are mounted crosswise on the front and rear wing spars. To absorb air load hitting the spars, three aluminium tubes called compression ribs are installed. These will keep the wooden ribs from flexing under pressure. The compression ribs are connected using crisscrossing metal rods. More glue is applied to critical areas. An aluminium trim is nailed over the front spar and nose of the ribs. This is called the leading edge because it's the part of the wing to hit the wing first, so it takes the brunt of the air load. Finally, reinforcement tape is laced through the ribs in a cross pattern. The completed structure is now moved to the covering department, where it's draped in a heat-shrinkable polyester fabric. The fabric is cut to size and glued to the wing perimeter. An iron is then used to heat the surface and shrink the fabric until it's taut. Then polyester cord is stitched over the glued areas. A chemical is brushed on, which seals the pores in the fabric, priming the surface to receive a spray coat of polyurethane paint. This paint is a special formulation designed for aircraft bodies. The fuselage frame is constructed out of high-strength steel alloy tubes. An electrode torch slightly melts adjoining pieces so that they fuse to each other. Because there's no metal used to bond the pieces, this welding doesn't add any weight to the structure. Once the frame is painted, aluminium floor panels and bulkheads are installed. Lighter bulkheads made of mahogany plywood and spruce are put into the tail. It's then time to bolt the engine to the front of the frame. The engine drives a propeller made of either wood, aluminium, or a composite material. Painted aluminium body panels cover the frame, and the fuel tank is installed between the front cockpit and the engine. Next, the wings are attached to the fuselage. Vertical steel struts connect and reinforce the two levels of wings and are bolted to the attachment plates on the wing spars. Next to be mounted are the painted aluminium ailerons, the tail with its elevators and rudder made of painted fabric over welded steel, and then the engine cover. A windscreen and instrument panel for each cockpit go in. The front screen can be replaced with a cover to keep the pilots warm in cold weather. And now for us, it's chocks away.